Welcome back again. Hello, welcome back again to a new video. We are slowly getting back to, let's say, more normal videos once I figured out how this system works. And today we're going to talk about a little box that I got last week because I was doing a live event, and it's called the UltraStreamer HDMI. And I must admit I'm quite happy with it, and I will try to explain why I'm happy with it, what it does, and I think what it can grow into, because I think that's the most important part. So without giving too much context, I had to do a live event last week with four cameras, or three cameras basically, and four possible input from a presenter. I mix it all together, streaming to YouTube, and also do a copy, a safe copy, which I did on also another recorder. And I needed a box for that. So without too much looking around, I decided next to my backup, which would be my computer, just to get this box. This is about $400, and it's about the size of a big Apple TV, and lighter than an Apple TV, or even a small Apple TV, the old type. Now I might have to sneeze, sorry for that. So this is the box that I got. It's called the UltraStreamer HD from a company called, I forgot the company, oh well, it's over here. Of course I will put the link in the description. So from Megawell. And it comes in a quite a nice sort of package, which of course is not important. There might even be still some stuff inside it. So let me switch to the top view. It has an Apple-like feeling. I think that's empty, right? Yeah, well, everything is empty. So I took all the stuff out, but it comes in a nice box. So the next thing is already what you are seeing now. We are actually at the moment using this box to create this stream. So we are now streaming to YouTube, and I will try to explain a little bit what is happening and what I think makes this box kind of interesting. I only found basically one limitation that I think over time can be resolved, or just by a newer version. At the moment, this box is limited to basically do a 1080p 60 4 megabit stream maximum to YouTube. Now, YouTube itself advises to do about 4 to 6 megabits, so that could be higher. The nice thing, it can do two streams at the same time, while it's also recording to its own internal hard disk, or it can stream everything to a live phone. So there's a million features in there. I just want to point out a few things that I really like about it. For one thing, I think so far it's been extremely stable, and the way that it works is that, so let me just go around to the connections and try to explain which parts I like about it and why I like them. So basically, one thing which is nice is, which I'm already doing now, because I had to kind of take it away a little bit from my normal setup, which is about 50 centimeters that way, and put it over here, is that you can see that it has a power plug on there, but you can actually power it from a USB block. So that means that I already did a small test, and some people might have seen this, where I put this box into my jacket pocket, the inside of my jacket pocket, and I actually used to complete the system by hooking it up over, you can either hook it up over Ethernet, but also over Wi-Fi. So I connected it to my phone, put both of these boxes together with a small USB power block into my my pocket of my jacket, the inside pocket, so where normally your wallet goes, and hooked up one HDMI cable to my A7R3, and it was filming basically live to YouTube, which I think is awesome, and it works. Also last week during the event, and in the last week, I kind of used it for about 20 hours, and I haven't seen a crash yet. The only problem that I've seen, and maybe that's a feature or not a bug, is that if I turn it on, there's no on-off button. If I turn it on, it seems to be to start streaming right away to YouTube, which sometimes is not what I wanted. So maybe I'm just pressing the button sometimes by accident, Yeah, that's what it is. So the nice thing is that you see that on the phone that you can connect up, which is done quite easily. It connects over Bluetooth and then does a Wi-Fi connection. So it's, at least on Android, it's quite smooth. So I can actually can go out of this interface. Let me turn around a bit. Be careful not to drop the connection and show it like this. You can see that's now actually scanning for other boxes which are available. If it finds multiple, you can, I assume you can control multiple because it now says it found one box. And I can go to this box. Of course, can I go into settings, which I won't do now, but that has things like being able to set up the encoding streams and which places you want to stream to. You can do two streams at the same time. I don't think I will show it because it might drop connection, although I'm not sure. But you can set up basically a mainstream and a substream. The mainstream is basically for maximum of 4 Mbit, and the substream is, I think, 1 megabit, but I'm not sure about that. So I now decide to go to this box. And one thing I already like is that you can see it acts like a monitor. So this is also one area. Oops, let me turn. Well, another nice thing is that I found, it has to see my face now. Okay, it's quite good in connecting back to the system, which is important. And you can see already that it now opens up with two different flaps. One is local and the other is remote. Now, one thing which I already like is that since this not only has an HDMI input, but also an HDMI output, so it has a throughput, it means that you can actually use this as a review monitor, right? And it's actually not too bad in its delay. It's not perfect, but you can just walk away and look at what your output signal is doing, which I think is great, including the audio. So if I turn on the audio, and let's do that just for the fun of it, you should hear me coming back, ringing, 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 ringing. Ah! Well, there we go. So turn off the audio. Again, a nice thing, because the review monitor is basically an iPhone or an iPad, I can use my wireless earbuds to basically listen to my audio. Again, a great feature. You also see that I'm now in my local flap, and I can actually hit the record button while we are streaming this to the internet, I hope. Let's see if we still see movement on the internet, because I'm looking at my computer, which is on the other side. But I think we are still recording, so I'll put my hand here. And at some point I see myself, yep, I'm still online. But I'm also recording and streaming from the box directly into my iPhone. So that's another thing that you can do. And you can see you can do most of these things at the same time, right? So I think that's pretty awesome, and I can stop it now. And I can go to my photo album, I guess, if I press here. Or I took a picture, there's one of the two. But you can see that we have recorded, I think this was the picture that we have taken. But if I go to the previous one, nope. I'm pretty sure I recorded it, so let me go to the photo app. Let me, oh, there is my photo app. Go to my photo wall, and there you see that we actually took a picture, but we also took the video. And again, this is all happening live, so I think that's pretty cool. Was that actually a video? Let me check. Why do my videos always have to be messy? Yeah, I can promise you that's a video. It just didn't do a lot of movement, but you see that my hand will be coming into the picture pretty soon. Hopefully this won't be too much overblown, but you can kind of see what is happening there. So that's pretty awesome, I think. So let's jump back into the application, which is still running, because basically you don't need the application at all. So I'm now using my iPhone, but there's no demand of a connection. So basically what happens is that if you press this button, it will start streaming to YouTube. So if you press it again, it will go off. If you press this button, it will start recording to its own internal flash card, USB stick, sorry. And that's also a nice feature. And again, I can, from the remote flap, now also go to the live one again. And you can see there are different indicators. And I'm just checking if the you can see this good enough, that we are not too dark and you can kind of see it. Yeah, I think you should be able to see this fine, but just to make sure, I will tune a little bit the light level. So give me a sec. So you can see it a little bit better, I hope. So I don't want to press the light button because then it stops. I think I can press the record button and then it will also start recording from now on. Yep, there we go. So it's now also recording to the small hard disk or the small USB stick in this case. And you can see that the live stream now is about 4 megabits up to YouTube. So we are sending this to YouTube live. Again, I think a great feature. One thing that I think they should do is basically make sure that this you press this button and these buttons way too quickly. And I also think there's a lot of opportunity for them here. It's not only to create a local flap, but also create almost like a monitoring app and give us some things, tools like focus peaking, a histogram, being able to zoom in and out of the picture. I think there's lots of opportunities that this could actually work quite nicely as an external monitor. Remember, this box is not too big and it can run on USB, which we are now doing. So imagine that you put this in your pocket or even on your camera rig, and this now becomes your monitor, right? And a very powerful monitor because it can stream, it can set you basically create a network for you. I think that would be a wonderful sort of solution. So other features. If you go into this flap, you will see, I hope that you can read it. I want to make sure. So let me check on another monitor. I'm not sure if you can actually read this, or this might be again too dark. So I'm turning my iPhone a little bit less bright. Give me a second. Because otherwise we are doing something that you can't see, which is also kind of useless. Still have to get used to the how the iPhone 10 works sometimes. And I don't want to stop the application by mistake. What I was really impressed with is how well it is able to recover, if that makes sense. I'm still hoping that I'm streaming. I guess at some point I start trusting the whole system. But you can see that you have an HDMI input for your audio levels. You have your headphone out, so basically you can also listen back. Because there's not, so they're not talking about a headphone out on your phone, which you already have heard. But let me gently sort of aim this up. You see that there are also two connections there. One is a mic input, and the other one is a headset in output. So not only can you pass through the HDMI, you can actually also get audio out of this box. Again, for your headphones or for something else. Again. Very cool feature, and you can set the levels separately here, and I can decide even to open up, which is open for no obvious reason. But if I would add a microphone here, I can actually add an extra analog audio signal on top of it. So for example, you could use this box to record something like a gaming or whatever you're doing, and still add a microphone and overlap your audio track, which I think is pretty awesome. So what else can I say about this? I'm not sure if I should say more about it. I think we should leave it at this, and then maybe if, let me, you can see how easy it is for me to now change the, oh, well, it should be easy if I stayed in the correct menu on this one. But you can see that I can control quite a lot of the features. Let me go to this view for a second and hold it up. And it works quite nicely, and you can just walk it around. You can see that's almost like a live monitor. Let me stop the hard disk recording, and then you should see on the box, I think, that the light now turned off. It starts sort of blinking, which I think is a little bit confusing, but and if I hit record again, which I'm doing now, it should become solid. It also has indicators for if it has Ethernet, Wi-Fi, and other connections. So this is for the first time, which is also the first time that I'm seeing it. We now know that this video is 15 minutes long already, because it tells me it's 15 minutes long. It tells you the upstream. One thing I don't like, which I talked about before, I think there's lots of possibilities here to really turn this into a monitor, right? To add vector scope, to add a zooming possibility, maybe one-to-one pixel level tricks, but also add audio indicators. Because weirdly enough, it does supply audio actually to inputs, right? So an input over here, an output over here. But it also has, of course, the output of the box, if that makes sense. So basically, it gets a total signal. I'm being a bit confusing, but basically, it gets the audio levels from the HDMI coming in, but also from the analog input through here. So that means that they could show me basically little few meters so that I can see my levels and be able to adjust it on the fly. Because I can basically remotely, which I just showed you, adjust it, right? I could bring this down. So now it should be very soft, and we should get louder and louder and louder and louder and louder and louder. Oh, one thing which can happen is that a message gets through to your broadcast if you do it like this. So yeah, that's basically it. So if you have questions, please ask me. Like I said, I'm going to contact this company because I think they should add some of these features. This is not yet running their latest software, so maybe there are other tricks in here. And I will, in the next video, if you have questions about it, tell you about, of course, try to answer the questions about this box, but also see how they reacted to some of my requests, because I think there's a lot of potential in this box to even use it in weird situations. So just to end this video, tomorrow I will very carefully place it to the side. And the good news, I know that we are still running because I have this remote monitor. And in 2 days, or basically tomorrow, I have to go to Belgium and have to give a presentation for European Commission. And I need to show them a system that we are working on, which is called MuPop for museums, that you can quite easily create interactive television setups. And let me zoom out a tiny bit and also do it from the other side. You can see that, that doesn't make any sense. So from this side, so basically what you're seeing here is when I get there, they only most of the time only have one projector, right? So what you see here that I have an output HDMI switch, and I have two small computers. These are basically computer sticks, and this is going to be a presenter computer, another presenter computer, so that with one cable we basically can feed the whole system that the European Commission review. It's kind of like a review meeting. So I just feed this to their projector, and I can switch on the table using a small remote, basically to whatever I want to do, I want to show, which is basically these kind of small computers, because these are basically Windows computers which you normally would stick at the back of your television, and then you can transmit or you can do an application on it. But I will also bring this box, not because I'm, let me shift this over. I will also carefully again take with me with this box. Why? Because if I simply hook it up at the end before it goes to the main television, I'm able to record it. I can also transmit it, which probably they don't want me to transmit a review meeting. So I have to be careful not to press that button. But if I press this button, it will record everything. I can record the whole audio in the room by simply putting a microphone in here. And I can, like I said, record it on the stick. And I can use this as a review monitor. So let's assume that, which happens sometimes, their projector is not working, or you are at a presentation location and they say, well, yeah, we should have signal, our system is doing fine. That at least you can check if you put this at the end of your, let's say, your whole technical setup, whatever it is, and your output is HDMI, you put this box, because it has a loop through. If you put this box in the end, you can basically prove or disprove, whatever you want to do, use this box to see if they are right. And you can actually record, because we can go back and I can hit the record button and I can record it live on my iPad or on my iPhone again. So I think there are lots of very useful features where you can use this. The biggest complaint I would have so far is that the software that they put in there is not, let's say, taking it to the next level. They could take it way further, if you ask me. And from the hardware point of view, I think, because it stays quite cool, and it's, if I'm saying this is light, I mean it is really, really light. I would not be upset, let me put it like this, if they make it a little bit bigger. Well, or keep it the same size. But either maybe put a battery in there, that would be kind of cool, like a small battery, maybe the size so they can run for an hour. But more important, upgrade the chips inside, because probably in a year or 2 years they can do that. And basically up the specs a little bit so that you can do 8 megabit streams at the same time, both to the USB stick and to, let's say, YouTube or Vimeo. You can actually set up 3 or 4 different formats, but then you have to look at the menu. I can see what happens if I go into the settings, but if we drop, then this talk is over. So I'm going to say bye. See you in the next one. But there might be a few more minutes if it doesn't drop the connection, because I'm just not sure what it will do. So let's go back into the menu. So you saw the local, the remote, but I also have settings. So if I go to a remote, oh, it will go to the remote. If I go to settings, it might drop me, but see what happens. No, actually you can see that I have a software update. I'm assuming, but we will see if that's true by me keeping an eye on the computer monitor, that there's a software update. You can configure the internet. You can set up the flashcard. You can set up your streaming service, right? So now I only set up one. This box is streaming, so you have to be careful that you not you don't stop it, I guess. So the menu stays active, and also this is quite complete. And you can add multiple different places where you can stream to. So in this case, we are streaming to YouTube. So as you can see, quite powerful. I can't show you all the menus, but I don't think it's too bad. I think it's actually quite nice. So as always, I plan to record for about 5 minutes, and we are now already into 25 minutes area. So see you in the next one. And I think this is going to be a new habit, at least while I can do it. Although we could now do it on the hardware box, I think doing it on the software box is more fun. So see you in the next one in 3, 2, 1, go.